few minutes. In January of this year, she created the blog thisexceptionaljourney.com to share her story with the world. And she's writing a book, which again you will not find surprising after you hear her. Yolanda, come on up. And I'm so excited to be here, probably as you can tell. You know, just to be alive, first and foremost, of course. But to be here speaking to you all, I am so grateful and honored to be able to do so. So, a little bit about me again. I am a state leader. At 36, of course, we heard the words no one ever wants to hear. What are they? You have cancer. No one ever wants to hear it, let alone in your 30s or under 40 at all. So just to go through the process, I had stage 2B, IDC, invasive ductal carcinoma of the left breast. My active treatment went lumpectomy, 4 rounds of chemo, 6 weeks of radiation, just to let you know. So, I mean, in your 30s, you're not thinking about cancer, you're thinking about your career. You're thinking about if you're not married, getting married. If you don't have children, maybe having children one day. And unfortunately, very quickly, I had to make some very life-altering decisions. We all know about that, right? And not only very quickly, but these are decisions that you have to think about life or death, right? So it's not just, I wanna beat cancer, is am I gonna see next year? Is the treatment going to work? So very early, and very quickly, I had to make these life-altering decisions. But on the other end of that, I said, you know what? Cancer's not gonna beat me. It's just not. I have family and friends here. Hey, how you doing? And they can attest. I said right from the very beginning, I have breast cancer, but I will be okay. Did I not?
You did.
Thank you so much. But I'm going to be okay. I have faith, and I'm determined to make it. Now, it didn't come out of the blue, though. It took some hard work, crying nights, sleepless nights, but every day I was determined. So why am I here today? I just want to talk a little bit about some of the things that aided me to be able to walk boldly through my breast cancer journey. For everyone, it's not going to be the same. As we know, not even our treatment, our type, nothing, no two women or men have the same process with breast cancer, right? So we all have a unique journey, but I think some of the things I'll be able to say to you today, you can apply to yourself, okay? So I'm gonna put a little spin on it, you know? If anyone knows me, you know, I don't like to be cut and dry, you know? So I'm gonna talk about 5 things today, all right? The spin I'm gonna put on it is we're gonna talk about the 5 W's. Who remembers those? No? Fifth grade English class, Ms. Conrad, come on. No? So, the 5 W's. Ms. Conrad always told me, if you do not have the 5 W's, and don't forget the how, you do not have a complete story. So what does that mean for us today? Who's the lead character in this story?
You.
Well, us. The survivors. The co-survivors. Living on this journey after a breast cancer diagnosis, which is the story we're dealing with today. So you ready? Let's go. So, who remembers the first W?
Who?
Who? Yes, we got some scholars in here. So, the who. Now, once again, everyone's going to be different, and I want you to apply what I'm saying to your own journey, because everyone is going to be different. My who was my tribe. Everyone knows what a tribe is, right? What is a tribe? A tribe is a community of people that have ties. It can be blood ties, religious, social, economic. It can run the gamut. But my who was my tribe. I learned very early and very quickly who was going to be in my corner after my diagnosis. Anyone can attest to that?
Yeah.
I had to figure out very early, okay, who's gonna be able to sit with me at doctor's appointments? Who's making phone calls? Who's texting? You know, who's able to take me to doctor's appointments And early on, I had to figure that out on my own. So what can the tribe do for you? First of all, let's deal with the not so good. You have to be okay with who falls away. That's inevitable. And unfortunately, there were the people I loved dearly, people who I thought would be championing for me, and they were nowhere to be found. So I had to learn on this side that it's okay if everyone's not there. That helped me to deal in the reality of where I was. But then I also had to realize I had to lean into and appreciate and love the people that were here. Because those are the people who are calling and texting and checking and making dinners and taking me places, right? So we have to deal with the bad. Everyone's not going to be here. But we have to deal with the good. And to be honest, I have to take a step back and even accept love from the most unexpected places. People in my church I never talked to. Coming up, oh, you need anything? I was like, I didn't even know you. What is your name? But from the most unexpected places, you have to lean into those that love you and appreciate those that just want to help. So how can you do that? It's already been spoken about. YSC, face-to-face groups, tons of resources online. We have an awesome group here in Pittsburgh. We would love for you to be a part. And probably where you are, there's a group where you are as well. So find a support group if you can. Wendy from Cancer Caring, they have a group called YACS, which is the Young Adult Cancer Support. I am a part of, some of the ladies are a part of. Find a group of people just like you. Now, it doesn't mean it's going to be someone just like you, but they'll understand your journey because they've been there. Make sense? Awesome. So who's our who?
Tribe.
All right, I'm sorry. Who's our who?
Tribe.
Thank you. All right, wonderful. So next, what's the next W?
What?
Oh my goodness. Thank you. So this one is crucial. The what is honesty. It's already been spoken about a little today, but we know we have a new normal. We have to be honest with ourselves. I had to be honest and say, I am not the same person I was before. Whether that's physically, whether that's mentally, emotionally, I don't even process life the same way anymore. So I had to be honest with myself, and then I had to be honest with those that were around me, because if they don't know where I am, they don't know how to love on me. They don't know how to treat me. I had to be honest with myself. So I had to take inventory. Every once in a while, take a step back and be like, okay, how you feeling today? What can you do today? What are you capable of getting done today? Like I said, it's already been said. You have to be in the moment where you are and be honest with that. I mean, am I the only one? In my 30s, I'm 39 now, I felt like I had to play catch up a little bit. Does that make sense? So I had to be honest. Okay, I may not be able to have kids. I have to face that reality. I may not ever get married. And like our young lady was saying, men can be a little, especially after a diagnosis or fortunately, I still have these. But either way it goes, just the diagnosis of information given, men are like, oh, okay. And they chunk the deuces, right? So it's not easy, but you have to be honest. This new normal is not easy. And every day, it's something different. But it'll unfold if you allow it. Does that make sense? So if you live in your honesty and you allow those people around you, your doctors, maybe your loved ones, your spouse, or maybe your children, know what and where you are, it'll give you a heap of relief down the long road. Make sense? Wonderful. So we have who, right? We have what? Next is?
When.
Thank you. Thank you, Rachel. I appreciate it. So now this one, and once again, it's already been discussed, and it is crucial. It needs to be talked about again. When is continual self-care? Daily, weekly, monthly, bi-yearly, it depends on you. Now, I know there are people in my life who know I don't always practice it like I should. But I do know that when I do practice it, it makes the world of difference. So let's talk about self-care real quick. We probably already know what it is, but just so we can cover it. It is deliberate or self-initiated care pouring back into you, being good to you. So for everyone, it'll look different. I know when I first started chemo, I mean, my mom was taking me right after chemo, oh, let's go get a mani-pedi. Like literally, I just had needles in my arm and my mom's like, let's go get our nails done. But I appreciated that because it was me pouring back into me after being in chemo. So sometimes you, again, have to take inventory and take a step back. What do I need right now? It can be mental. It can be emotional. It can be physical. I know I journal daily, try to journal daily, but at least weekly. It helps me to process everything that we're going through. And again, we know every day is a new journey. I journal. It can be something different for you. So I realize in the long run, it will help my overall well-being. Because what I don't do today may just affect me later on down the line. What can you do for self-care? Find what works for you. I know some people do yoga, some people do meditation. It's crucial to your self-care, because how can you pour back into someone else and you haven't poured into yourself? Make sense? Mm-hmm. Wonderful. So that is our one. Next is? Where's the where? Thank you. So this one is important to me because if I was honest, this is the one that really helped me. The theme is live your best life after breast cancer. This where is outside of breast cancer. So here's breast cancer. You want to live here. Breast cancer outside. Make sense? So what does that mean? That means, you know, we go to the doctor. Yolanda, yes. Date of birth, 4279. You're walking down, this is the hallway to the doctor's office. What's your date of birth? Okay, take your shoes off, step on the scale. Let me get your height. Okay, step in, the gown's on the table. You sit on the crinkly white paper, right? But we do this. I mean, sometimes every 6 months, depending upon how many oncologists you have. I have 3, I think, 4 maybe, can't remember. But we do, this is our life. Now me, I'm Ned, no evidence of the disease, but that's not everybody's case, but even if it's not, we live with cancer for the rest of our lives. In some shape, way, or form, whether it's decisions you make, can we go on vacation? I know I have some sisters, pink sisters, who have lymphedema. How long can I really travel? How long can I fly? How long can I sit on a bus? It literally shapes every decision that we make almost every day, am I right? So what I've learned, excuse me, and what my tribe helped me to do is live outside of that. Like I said, my mom was like, let's go. We're gonna go get our nails done. Yeah, you just went through this, but this is what you can do as well. What does that mean for you? Try some new things that have nothing to do with your breast cancer diagnosis. Now, does that mean you're not going to remember in the back of your mind you're a survivor? No, I have to take my tamoxifen right now. However, what that does mean is you start seeing yourself as more than just a breast cancer survivor. You start to see yourself as more than just a cancer patient and a number on a chart with the date of birth, a height, and a weight. Does that make sense? So what I did, we took trips. We went to Cleveland, we went to DC. I mean, I was always trying something new. So we went to a water park, and you guys know that little water thing? It has the hoop, the swoop, and the water is really fast, and you can like stand on the board. My big chocolate self, okay? I was standing in line. Everyone else was like little teeny boppers, and I was moving in the line right now. And they kept looking at me like, you about to get on this? I was like, absolutely. And I did it. I would have never done that before. I would have had the gumption to even get in line with these teeny boppers. Sis, didn't I do it? Jumped on board. Even the people who were working the ride, they were like, yes, good for you. But I tried new things. Things I would have never even thought to try before, because I knew that I was more than just my breast cancer diagnosis. Make sense? So what can you do? Think about it. Go on trips. Go to different places that you've never gone. Different countries if you can even. And include your loved ones, because they want to support you. They do want to help you. And if you do it right, they might even pay. Hello. All right, so we have our who, we have our what, we we have our where.
Did I skip one?
When, yes, thank you. And now why. This one is important to me, and just like Jen was speaking, you've got to pay it forward. You have to. Now, it, again, can be different for everyone. I started a blog because, I was loving social media. I'm grateful for my support here, our Facebook groups that we have. But I wanted to reach the masses, and still do, and will.
Hello.
But I wanted to get out in writing and let other people see that you can and will beat breast cancer. I didn't want to just put up a, 15-word post, hit send. No, I want it to be impactful. So how can you pay it forward? Now, we're here at the symposium. We're going to learn a lot. We already have, but we're also going to learn a lot of information. You can take that. And just like it's been said, you can share it in social media. You know, you can have pamphlets and give it to other people that are just starting, because we're here. And just like it's been said, some people never even make it to a conference like this. They don't even know it exists. So you can pay it forward just by being encouraging. If you know that you've made it, give someone else that encouragement as well. Look, this is what I had to go through. This is what I had to face, but you know what? You're gonna make it. Like, look, what can we do? Do you need a ride to your doctor's appointment? Paying it forward to those people that are where we were. The greatest thing about it, though, is it'll become a ripple effect. So if I help you, you help this person, no one is left behind alone to deal with the disease. Make sense? So think about how you can do it. It can run the gamut. I'm soon, probably, maybe, gonna start a podcast. We'll talk, we'll see about that. As you can tell, I like to talk. But it can be however it works for you. I started a blog. Maybe you wanna get your article in a newspaper. Share your story. Maybe you wanna be in a magazine. Contact the editor. However that works for you, but it is crucial, like it's been said, it is crucial that other women and even young men who are dealing with this disease see hope. It is important that they see someone on the journey making it. Make sense? Wonderful. So that's it. I mean, I have one more. How? So I decided to be creative. And to be honest, the how is up to you. How can you incorporate these 5 W's into your life? With your tribe, you know, with you being honest, envision it. Envision you living your best life after breast cancer. Again, these are my 5 W's and how. But what does it look like for you? I honestly believe if you were to incorporate these 5 W's that we learned way back, that you really could see a turnaround, that you really could live your best life after breast cancer. So hopefully they helped. You know, I honestly believe we beat cancer every day by how we live. It's not, you know, like I said, I'm Ned, but even if I wasn't, I have metastatic sisters here, hey y'all. But it's every day you beat it by what you do, by how you live, and how you love on others. Don't just keep it to yourself, love on someone else. So there is light at the end of the tunnel. You will make it. I can attest, you will make it. And again, you beat it every day. It's not a today, it's long term, day by day. And that's how you beat it. So again, I hope they helped. Find your 5 W's, and I believe you'll be living your best life after breast cancer. Thank you.